Hello and welcome to Lot Nice Knitting. A little bit scruffy today because we've got the dye pots on again and we're doing some experiments, and I think it would be really lovely to just share the process that I go through when I am dealing with a new material. So today I'm beginning the process of experimenting with a plant material called white butterbur. There's a leaf of it just here. We'll talk about that in a sec. The reason I'm carrying out this experiment is because I am a volunteer with our local woodland community group, and I spend a lot of time in the woods looking for potential dye materials. And one of the kind of pieces of work that we do is to remove invasive non-native species from the woodland and help to encourage the regeneration of ancient Caledonian forest, and that's something that I am so passionate about, and I'm extremely proud and honoured to be a part of a very, very small part of that process. And it's a wonderful opportunity to bring dyeing skills to the table and see what we can do to help change the relationship of the nature of understanding between people who are using the woods and managing the woods now, and perhaps see invasive species and non-native species in another way. Because the way that I see those species as a natural dyeing enthusiast is as potential and as a resource for dye colours, and particularly if they're non-native species, there's a wonderful opportunity there to find out about something that hasn't been part of our dyeing tradition in Scotland and the Highlands, which has a very strong natural dyeing tradition, and see if there's something new for us to learn and bring to the table. So that's the start of the process and the reason why kind of I'm looking at these things. There's a number of plants that I'll be looking at as part of this project, and hopefully within the next couple of months we'll be able to offer some workshops and teaching opportunities to share these skills for individuals and community groups as well, and people managing woodlands elsewhere, because I do think that there's a really lovely opportunity to share skills here. So the first plant that we've started with is the first one to pop its head up in the springtime, which has been the white butterbur. That is a broadleaf low-lying plant. It has a similar plant species to rhubarb. It comes up through rhizomes in the soil. It's come up nice and early in the spring. It enjoys shady, woody and damp areas, so you'll probably find this by rivers and ponds. And one of the reasons why this particular plant causes issues is because it does grow so quickly and spread so quickly and so easily, that it shades out the opportunity for other smaller plants to come in after it in the species. Hello, Freya. Are you going to join us? Okay, that's fine. Yeah, so the butterbur shades out the other plants that we might want to come up. And at this time of year, it's springtime. You know, you might think of things like bluebells or sorrel. Oh, not in there, Freya. You know, there are some beautiful woodland flowers that like to come up in the springtime and take advantage of the sunlight that's coming through the canopy before the leaves have come completely through on the more mature trees. And unfortunately, the butterbur, it gets there first and it shades out the opportunities for those little native flowers to come through. So, you know, personally, I'm not saying that I want to remove the plant completely, but there is a good argument there for managing and controlling its presence within the very special areas of woodland that we have in Loch Ness. So as far as I know, there's not a established history of using butterbur as a dye material, although it does have a strong tradition of being used as medicinal material. So it has been part of man's human development and traditional medicine for a very long time, but I'm not an expert in that field, and so I don't want to give advice on that that might be misdirected. But as far as I know, and I'm not an exhaustive expert, it doesn't have a tradition of being used as a dye material. And even if it did, some of the historical information that we have about dyeing, particularly on some of the plants that were less easily available or didn't give colour easily, we don't have directions about them, and it's more just a reference that something was also used for dyeing. You know, grows quickly, also used for dyeing. And there's not always a lot of information on the process, so it's sometimes best just to start from scratch. I've just encountered this plant species, and this is what I'm going to do to dye with it. Okay, I've got a couple of notes here. I'm going to refer on my phone to make sure I'm covering everything. Okay, so the first thing I do is I look at what the plant actually is. Excuse me while I reposition. Okay, so I just have a look at the plant, where it is and how it's growing, what type of plant it is, and just try to get to understand the growing conditions. So butterbur is a broadleaf plant. It has a long stalk, and then underneath it, it has quite a tuberous, chunky root. At this point in the year, it's not flowering, so I don't have a flower to work with just at the moment, but that does come later. And there are male and female flowers, which are separate plants, so they also might have different dye potential. But initially, I've broken the dye test experiments into the root, the stalk, and the leaves. So those are the three starting points. From there, what I do is go on to the next level and break down again and say that we will explore the use of those materials as a fresh dye, as a dried substance, and as a soaked substance. So that's what I have in front of me at the moment. You can see that I've got the leaves, the stalks, and the roots drying. And I've got leaves, stalks, and roots soaking. I do have leaves, stalks, and roots going on fresh as well, but I shall save that for the next video. So what's happened with the butterbur leaves is these are quite crispy at the moment. They're very dry, they've gone like paper. It's actually really interesting to note that the origin of the name butterbur has something to do with these really large broad leaves, which were actually used to wrap and store pats of butter as they were being sent from the farm to, I suppose, other households for use. So that's my understanding of the name. The stalk, which is drying nicely here, and the roots, which as you would expect for a plant that grows in a shady and damp area, when you first pick the roots, they're very swollen and full of water. As they've dried out, they've really shriveled up, so that's going to be really interesting to see what happens next with them. I've got the leaves soaking, and one of the things that I've noticed in the soaking leaves is the fact that the reverse of the leaf that has these fine silvery hairs on it appears to be water repellent, whilst the top of the leaf seems to soften and absorb water very quickly. So that's something else for me to know in terms of how I might think about the material breaking down as we apply heat for the dye. I've got some of the stalks soaking over here. You can see that initially the water has taken on a colour, which might be a good hint that there is some dye potential in the soaking there. But of course that isn't always a clear indication of the final colour and what will happen when we apply heat. So don't be fooled into thinking that this is going to be the end product. And finally, in the jar here, I have a small quantity of the root that has been soaking for the same amount of time as the other two. You can see that this root, if you get close to it, has not shriveled in the same way that the dried root has. It's maintained its thick, tuberous look, and the water has changed colour. So again, that might show a potential for some pigment there. Although lots of plants, when you soak them in water, do just change the colour of the water as part of the decomposition and breaking down process. And that's not a bad thing. You can get a kind of a generic pastel natural yellow from most plants as they break down. And that's a really lovely colour to work with and to start with. So that's where these experiments are. at the moment. And what I would do next with these is go through the process of heating and trying to extract dye. And at that stage, what I'll do is also apply and test out with mordants. So what I'll do there is I will test what happens when the yarn and the dye are in more acidic conditions. So I'd probably do that by using a mordant like citric acid or alum or white vinegar as a good kitchen kind of household easy thing. I'll do it without any mordant at all, so that's leaving the pH in the fairly neutral part of the scale. Although it's important to note that the water in the Loch Ness area actually starts slightly at the acidic level, it's not completely neutral, and that's to do with the water running off the hills and through the peat around here. I'll do another experiment that takes the pH of the water into the more alkaline level of the scale, and I can do that by adding something like sodium bicarbonate to the water, so I can see what effect that has. I can also test out with a couple of metallic mordants, the key ones being iron and copper, and they can have quite a transformative effect on natural dyes. This is a reaction that takes place there. So you can see by the time I've done the three types of plant source, plus the three types of preparation, plus the various kind of mordants, that you could actually end up with about, I think my calculation for this is it could be up to 40-45 experiments. It doesn't necessarily mean that I'll progress them all through to a final dye. For example, if something hits the water, I heat it to try and extract the dye, and there's just nothing happening there, I probably won't submerge yarn in it, or I'll submerge just a tiny quantity of yarn and pull it out, but I won't unnecessarily waste skins of yarn on that test, because I wouldn't be able to use them again, and that would be quite wasteful. So I do have to make some kind of informed decision along the way. And when I carry out the testing, I use these mini skins of yarn. So I'm only dyeing a small quantity, and that means I can work with less water and I don't have to waste a lot of water. I also don't waste a lot of yarn. I label them up with the details of how I've dyed, so I have a visual reference of what I've done, and I keep these. I hope it doesn't seem too wasteful, but I don't actually work with these. What I do is I store them so that I can see the effect of fade over time, because natural dyes do have a tendency to fade, and it's very important for the people who are buying my natural dye products that I can have a good conversation with them about their expectations of the product. So my understanding and my examples of fade are really important, so I do keep those for that. And as I also offer a custom dyeing service, and just for my own record, what I also do is a database card where, again, I write down in as much detail as I can the process of the dyeing, and I have a small sample there, and that will help if somebody is looking for a natural dye order and they want a colour but they're not entirely sure. We can help point them in the direction of a colour and narrow down their preference. So this is just a sample of a few of the cards I use for that. So that is week one of the Butterbur experiments, and I'm really excited because working with these non-native and invasive species and things that are causing a problem in our woodland is a really exciting opportunity, and I am very passionate about sustainable dyeing as well as natural dyeing. So fingers crossed we're going to get some good results. If you're interested in those, check back for the next episode where I will show you the results and talk you through exactly what happened, when and where, and hopefully we'll have a successful finished item of yarn to show you. Thank you very much.